equipment, heavy equipment for streets, we can do that and allocate it like that. But I wanted to say, what would a maintainer cost?
And just so you know, after this goes through, it'll go back to Victor and Jeff Kuhn to look at. If there's any questions about specificity or things of that nature, they'll send it back. But as long as we have a general idea in there, I think it'll be enough if you say street maintenance and construction equipment. That would cover it.
Curbing machine?
I don't know if I would get as specific machines, just because then you are limited to those funds could only be used for a curbing machine if in fact we needed more for a road grader or something like that.
But we could put some money, you could set aside money in here to talk about curbing itself and talk about doing some street improvements, because you can use additional funds other than street maintenance funds to improve your streets. So you could say for street improvement, you know, you could say street equipment and improvements, because of course curbing would fall along that line. Curbing is not allowed, sidewalks is not allowed in your street maintenance, it has to be the street itself. And so if you wanted to do some curbing in some areas, you could put that in this portion if you care to.
What is your recommendation, Ariana?
Well, I recommend the first option.
Of course.
What's your feeling about that, Connie?
I agree with the city manager, and only because the interest rate right now is so low for the tax note, and then the period of time that we're going to pay it back, it's only 7 years. It's not like we're getting into debt for 40, 30 years. And then all these repairs and equipment is needed. The city hasn't had any maintenance or repairs in years, so we need to improve that. And let me tell you, $2,550,000 for what we're gonna do is not a lot of money, because it's gonna improve the city significantly.
So from a financial forecast or standpoint, I mean, you feel confident?
Yes, and I can tell you, and I have kept that promise, as I told you on the first tax note for 2015, funds that are not used, we're gonna return. And that's exactly what we're doing. That's the reason why we're going for a second tax note, so we don't commingle the funds. So I can tell you that if this goes through and there's funds not spent, we're gonna send them back as a payment. Because we also have the option to get these tax note as we can pay it whenever we can. We don't have to keep it for 7 years.
The interest rate coming on our first tax note, the 1.2?
Was 1.7, and this one is 1.2. So it's very low.
On those police vehicles, you're gonna stretch that out over 3 or 4 years, or is that going to?
Well, what I spoke to the chief when he put it in Ronnie that he wanted 3 vehicles, what that would mean for the next 3 to 5 years, he could not come back and ask for another vehicle unless he was able to find some forfeiture or seizure funds that are coming in addition to it. But he said he was fine with that.
Okay. So you're not buying 3 cars next week?
No, sir.
Okay, it'll be stretched out over a number of years.
It can be stretched out whenever you want. We can do 1 a year over the next 3 years, or just during a 7-year period. It would definitely be up to you.
Because these purchases will come back to council like we talked about. So if he wants 3 cars and comes over, you say, no, we'll give you 1 this year, 1 next year, and 1 a year after that, council can say that.
And what I wanted to point out on the police cars is that in 2013, we went out for a governmental capital lease, and that loan, it was just for one police car, and CAPSI, and it was almost $150,000. The interest rate was very high. So in order for us to do the most sensible way of borrowing money and be paying it without losing a lot of interest will be this way, putting it on a tax.
We're borrowing money on top of money. I mean, here we are.
We're about to pay that already. It was for 3 years. It was something that my prior company.
But we're having to raise taxes right now to meet our budget. That you said we're going to be 95,000 shy of what we're supposed to be getting, and you're asking us to raise the taxes, and then we're borrowing money on top of that. Mm-hmm. So where's the city going to be?
Okay, let me explain that. These past, after 2013, we have already purchased 3 police cars. Those police cars have been purchased.
I'm not talking about police cars, I'm not talking about anything. I'm talking about in general.
That's what I'm trying to explain. That we bought them in cash. We didn't borrow that money. we didn't go out there and acquire debt. So now, because we have to raise taxes because of this debt, the raise taxes that we're gonna do this time, it does not include this tax note. Now, the taxes are not being raised out of proportion. We are using the road tax rate to increase the taxes. So we are not gonna have to fall back into an election to roll back the taxes. Normal growth of a city, you have to raise property taxes somewhat.
We haven't raised them in years.
That's the reason why we're in the situation that we're in.
No, well, but these years, these past 4 or 5 years, we've had a lot of tax sales, tax money, and everything else, so we didn't have to raise those taxes.
Yeah, but that's coming to an end too.
Well, that's why I'm saying that here we are borrowing money on top of that, so.
Yeah, but this money is not gonna be used.
Next year or the following year, we're gonna have to raise the taxes again?
But this money is not gonna be used to operate the city. This tax note that we're borrowing is gonna free up some of the money that we have on operating budget, so that way we can make it this year. And as you saw on the presentation that I did last night, we're not getting any additional revenue. If anything, we're less. So raising the taxes is not gonna give us additional revenue that we need, but we're not on the hole.
It's not gonna give us an additional revenue?
It's only $95,000, sir.
That's the only revenue we're gonna get?
Excuse me?
It's not $95,000 that we're getting from?
No, it's a list. We're gonna be $95,000 short to meet the operating budget for general fund only.
No, I understand that.
That does not include sales tax, so we still have other monies coming in.
We still got other monies. This is only the shortfall on property tax.
For MNO and IS? For MNO?
Yes, for MNO. INS, we're always gonna make it.
Any other discussion? Any other questions about the tax note?
Mary, myself, and you know, three other councilmen on this board yourself, we've all been in here, you know, for 5 years, some of us, you know, 10 years before, and we pride ourselves on having low tax rates. But I mean, what we have to show for today is more than that. You know, that's why the city's in the condition it's in, because we haven't raised property taxes. I mean, simple economics tells you, you know, if you don't raise taxes, and with M&O costs going up, I mean, you're going to fall behind, and that's where we're at today.
Yeah, but our sales taxes were
great. We can't get sales tax revenue.
The majority of you, I mean, that's what it's for. If you never prioritize on what you're buying and what you need, or the city's needs,
you can prioritize on what you need, but the thing is, the cost of your needs are going up.
May I have a motion, please? And identify. It didn't go, it failed for lack of a second, so I need a new motion.
I so move to approve a Frost Bank tax note in the amount of $2,550,000 to include capital improvements for City Hall project, life safety and ADA compliance, park improvements and infrastructure, police vehicles, street maintenance and equipment, park maintenance equipment, utility truck with crane, drainage, and sidewalk project improvement.
Motion has been made. May I have a second?
A second.
Whose voice was that? Say it louder. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Do we have any citizens' comments on this topic?
I'd like to ask a question. Last night, y'all were talking about how money and water.
Would you come up to the front, please?
I'm fine here.
No, sir, that's a rule. So you're a speaker, you come up to the podium.
Ain't no rule.
Okay,
No, my question was is how are we gonna pay for it? They said, of course, raising taxes, but last night on that workshop, y'all said it was gonna be $94 to the 100,000, right? To each resident. Was that correct? We told quarter last night.
That's a percentage of
So how much is that percentage or on the raising? Because we're talking about $94 on 100,000, so if somebody got a house for 150,000, which is an average, it's about what raising about $150
a year.
A year. Just wanna know how you're gonna pay it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. All right, any other citizens' comments? No other comments, let's take a vote. All those in favor of approving the Frost Bank tax rate for for a tax the item presented for the $2,550,000 with all the items that were listed. All those in favor? All opposed? Madam Secretary, did you get the vote?
4-1, ma'am.
Yes, thank you so much. Motion carries. All right. Do we need to table any of the other items? Remaining items? I'm sorry.
You what?
Okay, it's been a long evening, so I'm asking if it's on the table anything. All right. Item J, CNA investigating purchase order process for code enforcement vehicle and SWS contract. Councilman Ortiz.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Council, staff, and guests. Tonight, I want to get over this deal, ordeal, so we could come to a final conclusion. We know where it started and where it went, but we didn't get a definite answer from the community development director. When I asked her who signed the contract, she stated that she only received the vehicle. But in order to clarify that, I want to ask our legal counsel, Chris Hood, if she signed that contract, can you please tell the council?
Thank you, Councilman Ortiz. So if you look in your packets on item 3J, 1, 2, 3, 4, it's the seventh page on there, up in the top left. It says, it's got a block that says Caldwell Country Chevrolet. The seventh.
That's how it was last meeting, you know, I couldn't find it. Right. I knew it was somewhere around there, but I just couldn't pinpoint it. Oh, okay, I see it.
And so if everybody's there, getting there, this is what appears to be the actual purchase contract for the vehicle. This is the, if you look in that fine little lines down there at the very bottom box, you know, the purchaser agrees that this order includes all the terms and conditions, both on the face and reserve site hereof, that this order cancels and supersedes any prior agreement, XYZ. This is the actual purchase contract. And so that signature there, I haven't done any comparisons, but I believe that is the signature of the community development director on the contract itself. Now, I'm not sure if she knew that she was signing the contract. I can't speak to her mental intent. But Councilman Ortiz had asked the question, who actually signed the contract, and this is the actual purchase contract. So a lot of this goes into what the process is for purchases. And if Councilman Ortiz doesn't mind, if I can kind of tie this into a future item on the procurement policy. And Councilman Ortiz also sponsored that item on establishing a procurement policy. And part of the reason is to prevent things like this, where we've got throughout this whole process, back in February, a quote was signed off on, and some people apparently thought that that was the approval of the purchase, when it's just a signature of a quote. Then we have the actual purchase order that was done by the city, but no check was delivered, no contract was signed at that time with the Caldwell Country Chevrolet. Pardon me. That wasn't done until May. So as I believe Councilman Nieto can probably tell us better than anyone else, before you sell a car, you sign the sales contract for that vehicle. So that's where we're at. And whether it was purposefully signed or unknowingly signed or anything else, these are the kind of things that a purchasing policy is designed to protect against and have a formalized manner of doing this. Because up until this point, you know, we could have walked away from the deal, we could have done anything else, there wasn't anything. And the actual person who incurred the legal obligation on here appears to be the community development director.
Who's that?
Mindy Riley, I believe.
And who approved that? Who allowed that to happen?
I don't know if there was any specific person who allowed that to happen. The city manager had signed off on a quote, and she can probably speak to that if she'd like.
I believe she signed it the day that they delivered the truck, and she thought they were just signing for the delivery receipt of the truck.
And who approved the truck?
I did.
You're the one who ordered the truck and approved the truck?
Yeah, because I said before, in previous meetings, the specification came from Mr. Evans.
Mr. Evans doesn't have nothing to do with this. This is from the city side. He's on the police side.
And he spec'd the check out about what was there. We talked about that truck in reference to it. And as I said in my enthusiasm, as I said before, I should have come before the council again. I apologize, but in my enthusiasm, we're trying to go ahead and move forward with the code enforcement. But that's, I signed and approved for the truck. I know you have reminded me more than once in reference to my starting capability. As I said before, all vehicles, all huge purchases, $25,000 or not, will come before the city council. And I would not make that error again.
We've heard from you, Henrietta, and we've heard from the city controller, and we've heard from the community development director, and she didn't answer that question. And it's not up to me to make that conclusion that who signed the contract. The thing is that now we have legal. Legal said the community development director signed it and purchased that vehicle. So now we have to move on. We have to have winners in administration and accountability too. So we must move on now to other things, but we got a bruising on this one, unexpected, and on the next one we'll hopefully try to go as fast as we can without getting another black eye.
Well, Councilman, if I may, Mayor, we're hoping the procurement policy will have to put some things in place so that we can make sure that we have that and then we can follow policy. I think when we go out to grants on some things that they ask for procurement policy, and so we'll have one. I think the councilman has actually, your attorney has actually prepared a sample for you in your package.
But this is not the first, well, that's a different.
Well, that's we'll, the other one, we'll talk about it and we'll move quickly. You know, so we'll heal and move on. And I just want to make this public that this is not an interrogation or harassing anyone or any department, because the one that is accountable to us is our city secretary and our city manager and council cannot discipline city employees under the charter. So, correct, Chris?
That is correct, yes.
Okay, so please don't be making any statements out there that it's an interrogation. That's a unfair statement. That's not my reason for My reason is to get to the bottom of this and be sure that it won't happen again. That's it. So we should move on.
Thank you, Councilman. So this is CNA, so there's really no action to take on this, right?
That's up to council. Councilman Ortiz is a sponsor, so it'd be up to him if he'd like to.
Can we go into executive session for this?
No, because at this time, there's no litigation on these. The other one that's on there, the litigation part of that has been settled with the approval of council previously on that SWS. So there's nothing in the Open Meetings Act that would allow us to go into executive session on these items right now.
So I would just like to move on.
And obviously that would take a motion to table, but my recommendation is when we do this, if we can skip directly to the procurement policy one, because that this discussion leads directly into that.
Take no action? But wait.
So may I have a motion to take no action?
Excuse me. There's another SWS there, and I just want to breeze through it.
Chris just explained it. Can you say it again?
I know, buddy.
Well, I can go through Councilman Ortiz. What the issue here is similar to what happened there. An employee had gone out and obligated the city to things that the employee shouldn't have been, had the authority or the right to obligate the city to. And this is where part of the procurement policy that's coming up here in a couple of items would come in to prevent this, to show that only certain people are authorized to obligate the city for any of these expenditures.
On this SWS,
just
our city manager was aware of that.
Yes, and I believe the engineer, Mr. Heimer, earlier said this is when it happened. I think this was Andrew's way of trying to fix what was going on because he knew TCQ was out there.
But you signed for that, not knowing the set amount.
Correct. And so.
And it's a big amount. It's not a little amount.
Yes, sir, as I explained in the executive session, and I believe you
and
all...
And you held that from the council?
As soon as we came, we needed to find out...
No, you held that from the council. According to the other Connie that was here, and David, you knew about it, and you told us that you did not know about it.
I did not know the total amount?
Or no, you said that you didn't know anything about it.
When it was going on, I did not. Not until
Mr. Hug, part of this was discussed in executive session. Should we be talking about that?
What's here on consideration?
Like I said, this is technically a new item on the issue, and since the litigation portion was settled, there's nothing to go into executive session on anymore.
Okay.
So this would be a new discussion on the issue related to city policy, not litigation.
I just want to make a comment, and it's a quick comment. The bottom line is that, like I had stated, Henrietta is accountable to us. She supposed to come to us. So we must move on now. But before we move on, I just want to make a statement here that we spend $9,579.56 on late fees. That's the point where.
And I can say that those were charged to the city when we did our settlement as part of that, and it's not a confidential settlement, so I can say they waived the late fees and
did
the charges.
They?
Yes, sir. And so that's when council had come out.
So it's no longer $87,000?
Correct. It was the $77,000. It was the cost of the actual invoices that city council had authorized settlement for the actual expenditures.
See, when things like this occur, you know, it throws your budget off, throws everything off.
Yes.
Especially when your city manager withholds information from you.
Yeah.
And
I can let her.
That's not right.
Again, Councilman, I will apologize for not...
I mean, there's no apologizing for that.
Well, I don't know what else I can do. I said that I will make sure that I bring everything forthcoming to the council. I see the error of my ways. I will make sure that you are abreast of all things at the time that I'm aware of them as soon as I possibly can.
Well, the thing is, you know, it's, you budget monies for certain things, and then when you think you have money in the kitty, it's already been spent, and you're withholding the information. So what are you supposed to do then?
Okay,
Mrs. Turner's already apologized.
Right.
I make a motion that we move on. Can I make a motion?
Well, someone needs to make a motion for no action on this one.
I saw move.
Ms. Cantu, you made a motion to move on. Believe that counts as a motion to table or a motion.
I second.
Second.
We should move on.
Motion and a second. Do we have any citizens' comments?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Please state your name.
I'm Doug Jones, and I'm your president of Parks Foundation, and I'm shaking like a leaf. Three of you, I believe.
Excuse me. Last, in our last meeting.
I won't say what the gentleman who was got, but I will say is that y'all have just talked about somebody expensing the city and charging money. On the 2nd of November, somebody represented by the Rios Law Firm said that the city council did exactly what y'all have just spent 20 minutes talking about. Somebody from the city council charged the city $19,000 in legal expenses the day before the election to get rid of one of your city council members. And I do find what Mr. Robles said to be true. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. Any other comments? All right, we'll move on. Vote, all those in favor of tabling or canceling or bringing no action? Thank you. All those opposed? Thank you. We'll go on to the next item.
Mayor, I was going to ask if you can flip the next two items, since we've been talking kind of about procurement, if we can stick on the procurement thing.
CNA to approve a procurement policy.
And this will skip ahead to L, which I guess is the next item in the packet. Anyway, and this is a draft purchasing policy that the city of Burleson, Texas has, and talking about the issues that have happened in the past and what the city has now, this is kind of a policy similar to the one that we would like to adopt for the city of Floresville. It goes over specific amounts that are in place. It does cover things like state cooperative purchasing and how you can use that to not have to go off your individual bids, because that's already been bid by the state. And as Mrs. Turner had mentioned previously, when we go out for a lot of these grants, they ask for our procurement policy. And right now, we can only say we use the state's general law for there, and then we have a council directive, and there's one thing in the charter for a construction project. It's kind of this piecemeal thing, so it doesn't look as great as a presentation for a grant package, which is all about the presentation of your thing. So that's one aspect. And then the other aspect, and the most important aspect, is to make sure we have something that gets followed every time for purchases, and something that is more than a one-page council directive, but actually covers what could possibly happen and prevent things that have happened. So this is a draft for the council to look over. It's a big matter to adopt, so it's not something we want to just throw out there. And obviously the numbers in here will change, but this is the format that we'd like to adopt, and kind of the same competitive, you see in there, there's sections on competitive purchasing, waiver of competitive purchasing. And so we'll bring this back, I believe, at the next council meeting with an actual City of Floresville one. But in the meantime, if anybody has anything they'd like to add or any specific questions, we welcome that, because this is going to be the comprehensive procurement policy. And we'll get input from staff as well, the controller, and other individuals there. And so there's really no action at this time. If we could have gotten one put together in time for the council to give it review, we would have done that. But since we don't, this is more of a presentation item.
I so move that under the table item 3L.
I'll
second
the motion.
All right. Citizens' comments? Under procurement policy? All right. All those in favor? Table. Opposed? Madam Secretary?
5-0.
Thank you. Shall we go back to K?
Yes.
The regarding permit fee process and notice to applicants?
Yes, Madam Mayor.
All right.
And so this had come up because some questions had been presented by contractors to the city about getting different information when they go to pay fees upfront and what fees are due right away and what fees are due later. And then some issues about where the builder didn't pay a fee and the homeowner who bought the lot or the house that was constructed there suddenly got told that they had to pay a huge fee for a connection and things of that nature. And so Mrs. Turner and Ms. Riley set up a meeting with myself, them as the city representatives, and the contractor who had the biggest issues on this, to talk about where in the chain there had been some gaps and things where information hadn't gotten out and where surprises happened, which is something you don't want in a permitting process. You want everything to happen by the book every time.
And smooth, smooth right.
Yes, sir.
So who's in charge of this?
That would be, I believe, our community development director and the city manager and the two that were present in the meeting.
I understand that overall it's, of course, our city manager, but we're starting to have issues again.
And I will say this, Ms. Riley was very proactive in the meeting about how to fix these issues in the future. She did put out there, we have an email list of all the contractors that are registered and saying that she would contact them with a procedure and changes and let the individuals who work up front know what the process is. And so you don't get people, I believe it was like $75 was the initial water, and then you've got the $2,000+ actual connection fee. And so it used to be you just came in, paid the $75, you'd go out, you'd start the construction and everything, and then you'd come in at some point in the process and pay that $2,000. That was recently changed to where you pay the $2,000 up front when you come in, and that caught this specific contractor and some other contractors by surprise. And it's something where they're willing to pay because it's part of the process, but just like everybody else, they have a budget and a timeline, and they weren't expecting to have to pay it right at that time.
It's an inconvenience and a party.
Yes, sir. And that was, it was Greensboro Homes, it was...
Yes, and one of the things that came out of the conversation for the meeting was that we would have, because we have contractors that have to register, so we thought about having an annual meeting at the beginning of the calendar year. They're required to re-up, and so we'll have a meeting available. We're not going to make it mandatory. We're just going to make the meeting so that people can attend if they have any questions and they'll be able to do so. Phelps said they would be at the meeting as well. We'll have a representative from our water department as well so that we can start a conversation, have a dialogue, and put some time on the name of the face. We've even reached out to our third-party administrator to see if they can attend this annual meeting that we would do every January.
Mr. Do you feel, I mean, with there's been similar complaints from businesses, residential owners, but do you feel the staff, I mean, is trained properly? I mean, do you think there's something that we can do with staff? I mean, because we're hearing the same thing across the board, and I mean, you know, and just to benefit them. I mean, because it's got to get tiresome for them also to kind of hear the same complaints, and, you know, is it us or is it them?
It's a new process. I mean, because it's a new process, so we're trying to work out the bugs, because definitely the permitting process has changed in the city of Floresville because we've added some new things. We spent 2.5 hours on the phone today with MuniCode going back and forth because in some places our ordinances said one thing and another place it says another. And so it can be quite confusing what people are seeing and what we want to do or not necessarily mention.
Are you saying this new process, we just started this?
The process that we're doing now with the permitting, and yes, the contractor's license, that's new.
It's less than a year, right?
Yes, it is new. And so that process is new. Our building fees are definitely new in reference to do that. Not necessarily a third-party administrator. Also, the applications that we do, those are all new as well within the last year. So I'm hoping that the bugs will be able to be worked out. But I'm thinking the information meeting that we can have and share with people, let the people know.
Is this occurring because we don't have an inspector?
Well, now, since I've been here, you've had a third-party administrator.
I understand that. I said, is this happening because we do not have an inspector? Because right now, we don't have no one that could go and do an inspection for a small remodel, something that will take a day or two to do. You know, call in our inspector, go and check it out. They pay the fees or whatever and get it done. Now, I mean, it's just taken a long, long process to get things done.
Councilman Jimenez, I did not hire and/or recommend Veritas when I got here.
No, I'm not saying that. All I'm telling you, we need to fix the solution. We've got a problem.
Problems.
I'll meet and see what we can do with staff to help streamline the process, but when the process that is there and inspection and how long it takes for inspections, it's because you have a third-party administrator. Now, if you want to not have a third-party administrator and hire in-house, you're still gonna have the issue with commercial development. Because if you have no in-home or in-house.
I understand, you know.
No in-house inspector is going to be able to be qualified that you can afford, that's gonna be able to approve a CVS or approve a multi-million.
We're not asking for that. I said, an inspector to do remodels, homes.
Residential?
Residential, commercial, I mean, that's another ballgame.
Yes, but when I looked into that, I don't think historically you ever had, did you all have an inspector?
Yeah.
Not the last 5 years.
Well, I mean, when I was in here, we had.
Yeah.
Back in 1989.
Can someone be trained that's there already? Are the two employees in that department, can one be trained?
Yes, because they're not to be trained, yes, sir.
Going back again, we had the same issue with the same guys, you know, with another department. You know, let's move them over here. See, what we need is people with experience who can do the job, not put them there and have another fall, and then come back and have problems, red tape, and a continuation. It's best to hire somebody experienced and pay them a reasonable good, but they'll get the job done.
I'll speak to HR tomorrow.
My thing.
And get a job description that we have. That's typically what we do. We have a job inspector to see what a in-house residential, but it will not address your commercial issue, but residential in-house inspector will cost. And we can look at that when we come up with that department, which will be, I believe,
yeah, because,
next week.
You know, there's people just trying to do a little sidewalk or whatever, months, even with their own judge. It took 2-3 months before he could even get anything done. You know, you go into the restaurant, the first thing they tell you, hey man, I'm having trouble with them.
Well, part of the problem is that you can't just put it on a napkin or a piece of paper. They actually have to submit a drawing. And that's one of the things that we have a problem is that the community wants to come in and just draw it on a piece of paper and say, this is what I want to do. You actually have to come in with a permit, you have to come in with your plan and have to actually draw it and submit what you're going to do, not just on the back of a piece of paper or notebook paper. I mean, we had somebody came in and said, here's, you know, I want to build this garage, and it was on notebook paper. We can't accept that. It has to have something with the site. You have to prove that you own it. You have to give it some setbacks. And so just say, well, it's going to be 5 feet off this, and won't work.
So you're asking that everybody has an architectural design?
Not an architectural design, but you have to have more of a plan that you can build that you do on a piece of notebook paper.
You can do your own.
You can do your own, depending on what it is. But we need to be able to have more concise. And so when they come in, we send it back, and that goes back and forth.
All right, so is there any action to be taken on this?
I don't think there is. Like I said, we had a meeting with some of the bigger developers. They're going to try to put together a meeting with all of the contractors in the city, from the big house builders to your local handyman-type contractors. And so everybody kind of gets familiar with these are the processes. This is what needs to be submitted to help streamline the process and go forward from there.
Okay, will someone make a motion to take no action?
I make a motion to take no action.
Thank you. May I have a second?
Second.
Citizens' comments? None?
All those in favor? Raise your hand. 5-0, Mayor.
All those opposed? Okay. Thank you. Motion carries. The next item M, CNA to adopt ordinance 2016-011, amending ordinance 207, cemetery fee and implementing a veterans burial fee structure. Councilman Ortiz.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Council, staff, and guests. This ordinance here, I found it in Elmendorf, you know. It's pretty good, but it was just a little tweak, you know, in there that had to be amended. And that was a DD 214. Plus, we had some issues with our cemetery, you know, some debris. But, we have here Chris, our legal here so he could update us on other things.
Thank you, Councilman. Sorry about that, didn't mean to cut. So we can really divide this into two parts, one that I can speak to and one that I'll ask the city manager to speak to. The first part is what Councilman Ortiz had mentioned in our workshop, and something that's I think well deserved, is veterans from Floresville. Right now, the only place where you can get a free interment is in San Antonio. It's some of the veteran cemeteries, the VA cemeteries, Fort Sam Houston, that is over there. And so for families to go visit them, that's a long trek for some people that don't drive into the city very often. And so Councilman Ortiz had said to honor these veterans, if we can do something to have them very close to home, where people can go visit them on the weekends and that. So we put in amended our ordinance to include some of the language that Elmendorf had, some other places have, and some that we've come up with Councilman Ortiz's knowledge and expertise on there, about allowing veterans to be interred in the city cemetery for a reduced amount. And I'll let Ms. Turner get into the actual amounts when she talks, but what we've got here is that a veteran is entitled to a burial plot for themselves upon proof of not dishonorable discharge. So honorable discharge, medical discharge, anything that doesn't qualify as dishonorable. And to prove that, they'll have to submit their DD-214, Department of Defense Form 214, which shows the length of their service, the character of their service, and the nature of their service.
And do they have to be a member of the city of Floresville, or?
Yes, they would be a resident of the city of Floresville.
For what time period?
Just a resident at the time of their passing.
What about ETJ?
We can amend it, but it would be residents of the city. It's the city cemetery. And so the burial there, you'd be entitled to one lot for yourself at a rate, and then you could get double stacked, like a regular lot, and that second person would have a reduced rate. Or you could get a second lot for a dependent. That could be a child, a spouse, a parent, anything like that, where you can have somebody that you want to spend eternity next to there. So that would be what we're offering to the veterans, and I think that encompasses what you were looking for on the veterans side. And I will turn it over to Mrs. Turner now to talk about the fees and some of the other.
Yes, and so I think that fee for the veterans would be $100, is that correct?
That's the proposed, I think it's.
So for veterans, on page 5 of 6, that's some of the changes. Now, we went and got the information from the Catholic Cemetery because we were using that as a reference. And so we took some of their items. We took some of their items that they do and how they maintain. And one of the things we talked about was maintaining, make sure they take care of the curbing and the fencing, and those rules are there. We had some, but we borrowed some from the Catholic Cemetery. So the fee schedule would change. So a standard non-veteran burial plot would be $700. And Monica, correct me, it's $500 right now. So we go from $500 to $700. The double stack for a non-veteran would be $1,000, and right now it's $800. And then, of course, the standard for the veteran that would qualify was $100. A double stack would be $150. And then,
These I can speak to. Right now we have a permit fee if somebody wants to lay a foundation for a statue or a monument or something that gets approved. It's called a concrete permit fee. I know in what you had sent over, you struck that, like the excavation fee. I left it there just because we will have to have somebody show that they're not gonna put down a little foundation, it's gonna fall over in there. So it can be a nominal fee to just have somebody go out there and make sure that it's,
when the headstone is put in place.
Or this is more for monuments when you're actually going to do concrete work out there. So when you're going to have somebody mixing and pouring concrete to create a slab at a grave site. Yeah.
And then the effective date would be, you have here August 1st of 2016. It also eliminates the contract and paying, so you have to pay it all up front, all at once. We won't have a contract where there'd be a payment plan, because I believe that we ran into some issues in reference to it not being there. We also have started laying aside all of our deeds to record, but right now we're waiting for county and their new system to start up in January. But there's also a recording fee that will be there assessed to whoever purchases that we can record that deed as well.
My question is residency. Is it 1 day, 2 days, 3 years, 5 years?
That's for council to look at. It's just residency. And so on the side, somebody could move here, pass away the next day, and be eligible. Or they could have lived here for 65 years and go live in an assisted living home or something in San Antonio and establish their residency, and then they would lose their residency at Floresville. So that is something that we can...
You have the veterans home here.
Right, for individuals that are here, but sometimes people go to San Antonio because they want to be closer to the veterans.
I'm saying, you know, like the people that live here in the veterans home.
They would be eligible.
They would be eligible to purchase a lot of water.
So how do you prove residency?
Water?
Yeah, a bill or a driver's license or something of that nature.
So that's what I'm saying, has to be some type of proof.
Right. Well, what about length of time?
And that's what, if council wants to, we can make amendments here before we pass it and incorporate something there. So you can do a resident of Floresville for the previous 2 years. You can do a life, I really don't want to say that because then you get people that move in and move out. But there's still, you know, I go off to college or I go off to serve, I'm gone for 20 years. Something happens, I pass away, my whole family's here. So you still want to be buried near the family so they can visit you, but you don't qualify as a resident because you haven't lived in Floresville for 20 plus years. So
I believe the ordinance is good, I support that, but I think that we need some clarification and some more.
On there.
Yeah.
What would be your recommendation? Do we want to limit to residency, or do we want to
have a residency clause? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah.
And how do we want to structure? That's my question, though. Is what do we want to have for residency? Resident of Floresville for 2 years. Because we can't really say, you know, if you have three relatives within.
I think that what they're getting to is that, you know, if say for example they live in San Antonio or they lived in, and they want a free burial where they come. Exactly.
Well, you can also have it like I'm
free.
Purchasing a plot for my son who was in the military, and I have his DD-14, but he didn't live here. He lives in San Antonio, but I'm purchasing the plot.
There's a lot of things here where if you limit it like that, you either have to say you have to be a resident here for 2 years. And whether that means you moved away for 20 years, then you're not eligible anymore.
What do other cities do?
To be honest, like Elmendorf, it just says resident, and residents proved by driver's license, electric bill, water bill.
And how many cities have that?
Quite a few of the cities have them. San Antonio doesn't because you've got the free VA, and then they've got a lot of private cemeteries.
Does it have to be 100? It can't be like half price?
That's up to council for the amounts on there.
The $100 came for, we used Elmendorf as an example for there, and that's what that price came for, the $100. That was the example that Elmendorf had.
She's asking if you can do half of 700.
You can set the price for it. Like I said, that's what was in the example that Council Ortiz bought was $100. And so that's why I just put that number in there, because that's what the sample ordinance was.
I mean, I could serve for the person that served, you know.
Exactly.
But not for the whole entire family. Or
it would be it's one, not the, you get one other person.
Just
a wife.
Just the veteran and one more. That's it.
But I think that's what it was in the Elmendorf as well.
Elmendorf, it said spouse. Here, yes. It would also qualify for
right.
Child
yes.
Or
it's just
parent. It's one.
Total two.
And,
so it would be $100 for two or $100
no.
Each?
It would be $100 for each plot if they were separately. If they were stacked on top of each other, it'd be $150.
Exactly. And to just make it short and sweet, my fellow veterans deserve more. They deserve more.
What I think to Councilman Jimenez's suggestion would be that technically all of the veterans that live in the nursing home now, there at the top, right, Tejadas, a veteran's home, we qualify for the $100 or the $150, because they are residents of Floresville.
Exactly.
Now, they may not have been, a lot of their residents now.
Like if their, and their wife isn't a resident?
Well, he would be purchasing the plot, and because he's a veteran and has residency, he could purchase for him, himself, and for one other. And that other would not necessarily have to live in Floresville.
If I do actually. If it was up to me, and that was my cemetery, I would, all of them.
I didn't figure that you can transfer to a non-veteran.
Right, you're gonna have to transfer, because there's a transfer fee also, for transferring lots.
Like I was kind of talking to Mike, what I want to make in here is so you don't have a veteran buy a lot and then transfer it to somebody who wasn't a veteran, so they get. That's what, but you can only transfer it to another individual who shows proof of service under the DD2.
Can we take this into a workshop? When do we want to put this, for October 1?
We were proposing for August 1. Really, it seems like the big question is the residency issue.
There's one to Councilwoman, kind of, she says that.
Oh, on the pricing, there's also that.
Can we discuss it in another?
Sure.
If you would like.
Sure.
It's a good idea.
If you'd like, I can have him make the changes, and you have red line again with the two suggestions, and then we can put it on the agenda for one of our workshops.
If you could look at some type of residency clause in there, Chris, just draw something up.
And I'll do my best to try to accomplish the goals. Nothing's gonna be perfect, there's gonna be a lot of loopholes, but for generally, we can get something.
Like younger vets, you know, they're 18, 19, they live here in Floresville, but their DD 214s show their, at that time, when they enlisted, their hometown in Floresville.
Correct.
So if they move out, say, San Antonio, let's put there a clause that will say they're eligible.
May I have a motion to table?
I so move.
I have a second. Two motions, and do I have a second?
I second.
I don't know who was first, I think that was.
Ladies first.
Let's fight, table it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any citizens' comments on this one?
Yes, ma'am, I have a question.
Would you please step up, sir?
Yes, ma'am.